One of the coasters that Japan is most famous for is Takabisha. This coaster holds the record for having the steepest drop on a roller coaster in the entire world, 121 degrees. And it is intimidating. Of all the rides at Fuji-Q, I would say this one is the most visually impressive. The layout is so cool with track just winding every which direction. Sometimes you see multiple vehicles going at once. It's just a mess of twisted track. It's really quite a sight. If there's any ride that you just want to sit back and watch, it would be this one. So this is going to be my full in-depth review about Takabisha, so that if you get the chance to go to Fuji-Q and check it out, you'll know what to expect. Now I will say, the two biggest stars of the show for us at Fuji-Q were Edge and Ika and Dododampa. So Takabisha did kind of get sidetracked a little. In fact, I only got one ride on it, and that was for a couple of reasons. The first one is, we know for a fact that a clone is coming to New Jersey. The track work has been completed. We have a name. It's going in the American Dream Mall. It'll be completely enclosed, so that'll add a whole different dynamic to it. And so because we knew that one was coming a bit closer to home for me, I was not desperate to get my rides in on Takabisha, because I figured I'd probably be riding one exactly the same less than a year later. So for that reason, Takabisha was not high priority for me. I think if the one that's going to American Dream Mall did not exist, I definitely would have ridden this more. But pretty much the other main reason why we didn't do this as much is because it did get quite a line, and when you have rides like Dododampa and Edge and Ika, in the end, you'd rather do those than this one. This coaster is still fun. I very much enjoyed it. But it's kind of what I was talking about, where it almost kind of gets pushed to the side. That being said, we still have quite a ride experience here. 141 feet in the air. I talked about that angle of descent, max speed 62 miles per hour, 7 total inversions, and one of the most unique things about this coaster is how it's split up into two sections. That crazy drop that you see is not the first thing you do on this ride. That is actually halfway through the ride. And that's something that when you're just watching it, you kind of forget. The ride starts off with a launch and then goes to the lift hill. That's what's so interesting about the layout. And I really like that, because what that does is it adds a buildup. It's something that you have to look forward to. So let's break down this layout piece by piece. As soon as you depart the station, you take a left-hand turn, go into a tiny drop, and into a heartline roll. That is your first inversion, is completely in the dark. So naturally, it's easy to forget that that part of the ride exists. Especially when you walk up to it, you see all the different elements. You kind of forget that the first thing you do out of the station is an inversion in total darkness. So I did quite enjoy that. But immediately after that inversion, you hit your launch, and that's actually when you hit your top speed. It is not at the bottom of the drop. You hit 62 miles per hour in 2 seconds, which is pretty good. I mean, Gerstlauer is known for having some punchy launches. One of the best I've had the chance to experience is on Fluke von Novgorod at Hansa Park. I wouldn't say this one is as good as that. However, this is still a very enjoyable launch. That's when you shoot out of a tunnel and hit that first inversion, which is this massive corkscrew. Like, if you look at how tall this thing is, I wasn't even sure how to originally classify this element upon first looking at it, because it just looks so different. It almost looks like an inverted top hat. Not quite, though. RCDB classifies it as a corkscrew. If that is the official title, then this might be the world's tallest corkscrew. I don't know. I mean, I don't know two other corkscrews that are this big. So that's a great first element. And then following that, you pop up into one of my favorites. It's the banana roll. This is great. It's 2 inversions back to back. It's a rare element. There's not too many rides out there that have this. It kind of looks like a cobra roll, except what they did was push it in, so it's a lot tighter and thinner. It gets that title because when you look at it from a certain angle, it kind of follows the contours of a banana. You really whip in and out of that. Yeah, when you have a 8-passenger vehicle, the whole layout is going to be designed where you take all these elements at a pretty rapid pace. So I would say pacing is one of this coaster's strong suits. All the elements are rapid fire. That doesn't mean you fly through some of the inversions, because some of the inversions are designed to almost give you a little bit of hang time or kind of stall you out at the top. Hang time is definitely not the primary purpose of these inversions, but for what it does do, I very much enjoyed it. Following that banana roll, you go into a second corkscrew. This one is a much more normal looking corkscrew. Very solid. You then go through a twist and hit your first brake run. So you slow down, you take in the fact that you just experienced the first half of the ride. You went through four of the seven inversions. You're now going to take a right hand turn and slowly approach the lift hill. Now, for a lot of people, vertical lift hills are pretty intimidating. To those who haven't experienced something like that before, that freaks you out. And you could argue that is one of the freakiest parts of the ride. Of course, as coaster enthusiasts, I think a lot of us really enjoy these moments. However, I gotta say, unfortunately, my experience on this vertical lift hill was not the best because we rode it at exactly noon. The sun was directly above us. So when we start the climb, we're staring directly at the sun and it was blinding. So we pretty much had to close our eyes the entire time or look to the side because we couldn't look directly ahead or else we would literally burn our eyes. Of course, that's not something we planned for, but it was an unfortunate side effect. So as you can imagine, it was quite a relief when you crest over and you hit that holding brake. Now I'll say this about the holding brake. It's a lot steeper than I was originally expecting. Like you look at it and you're like, okay, it's decently steep, but when you're actually on it, it feels like you're being held mid-drop. I kind of liken it to hang time's holding brake. I thought the same thing with hang time when I did that for the first time, but the difference is that holding brake is not just there to pretend like it's a dive coaster. That holding brake is really there so that they can achieve this ridiculously steep drop. If you look at how they formed this thing, it's really quite amazing. The structure itself is visually impressive. No wonder this ride has kind of gone viral among the general public. It's a freaky looking drop. And you know what? It holds up too. It's a pretty good drop. The holding brake releases you. You slowly go under yourselves 121 degrees. And that's when you build up all that speed back up. And from here on out, it's all inversions again. So next up, we got a dive loop. You twist out of that and go into what's kind of like an inverted top hat. It's almost like just a really sharp overbank turn. It is classified as an inversion. You definitely go upside down, but it kind of looks like this crazy overbank. And after that, you got an M and then the brake run. So even though you do less in the second part of the ride, I'd say the second half of the ride does feel still very complete. Ascending up the vertical lift hill builds your anticipation. That holding brake is gonna draw some fear out. That holding brake is gonna freak a lot of people out. You go into that crazy drop, three inversions, and just like that, you're done. I'd say overall, when I got off this coaster, I said that is one of, if not the best Gerstlauer Eurofighters I've done. It's not my favorite Gerstlauer. I still prefer Karnan and Smiler. However, both of those are Infinity coasters, so in terms of Eurofighters, the only one that comes close to me is Fluke von Novgorod, and I still haven't decided which one of those I prefer. I'm leaning towards Fluke von Novgorod, but I will still say this one is very satisfactory. It's a smooth layout, so even though it has those big over-the-shoulder restraints, they didn't bother me. And with rides like this, again, you just gotta keep your head forward. I've said that before, but on these Gerstlauers, that's really something that you gotta get used to. You will enjoy the ride more when you do that. I just think in general, this is a very quality ride. I enjoyed my one ride on it, and I cannot wait to ride the same coaster a lot more when it opens in New Jersey at the American Dream Mall. And so for its final score, I'm going to give it a 9 out of 10. As far as Gerstlauers go, this is definitely one of their best. But those are just my thoughts on the world's steepest roller coaster at Fuji-Q Highland in Japan. Let me know down in the comments below if you agree with the things I've said, if you've had the chance to experience that. If not, if you're looking forward to riding this when it opens in New Jersey. Be sure to post all your thoughts down below and stay tuned for more here at Coaster Studios. Hit that subscribe button and I'll see you guys in the next one.